I heard recently that you are leaving. You, our beloved weatherman, is leaving us. What's up with that?
Well, I've been at Channel 4 33 years on the morning show. Same job, same station. It's kind of unheard of in these days, especially in broadcasting. I mentioned we're kind of itinerant employees. I had a number of opportunities to go across town to the other stations, 7 and 13, had some opportunities to go on to the bigger markets. And in broadcasting, that's always the status. That's, you know, hey, I got to go from Albuquerque to Denver and then to LA and then to New York and then to the network. And, you know, I will be honest and say, you know, gosh, I have some really good friends and coworkers that have done that. And I am completely jealous and very envious. And it's like, I decided a long time ago that I was going to plant my roots here and stay here. And it started because of love for my son. I was a single dad. One of the casualties of my previous life, as I call it, was divorcing my first wife, my son's mother. And he was pretty little when it happened. And I actually took him with me to a job outside of New Mexico and loved it, but it was the worst year of my life, and it was really hard on him. And I'll never forget, we were out in my Jeep one day going to the swimming pool and just having a good time. And he said something funny as a little kid, and I cracked up laughing and reached over and just slapped him on the back and said, "I am so glad you're here with me." And he just stopped like I'd hit him with a hammer, and he looked at me and he goes, "But my mom's not happy, is she?" And it just killed me. Just devastated me. And here I was all proud that, well, I'm a single dad and doing it by myself, and she's in New Mexico and I'm here. And I said, no, she's not, but we'll fix that. And so started communicating with her. Long story short, we were kind of crazy. We never, ever talked about getting back together, but I convinced her to move to Tulsa so the two of us could be there to co-parent. And she did that, and no sooner did she find a job and get settled in than my job there started to blow up. This was part of this downward spiral that my drug and alcohol-induced behaviors were part of. It wasn't all that. And I never missed work. I was high-performing. I was having outward success, but inwardly, I was dying. I was falling into deep depression, suicidal thoughts, just lost. And the more I had, the more I wanted. I couldn't get enough money or substances or women or accolades, anything. And I look back now and I see I had a hole in my soul, and whatever I poured in just ran right out. And Jesus took care of that for the most part. But stayed here and, you know, had to leave that job. And lo and behold, she's like, "Oh, I'm not moving back. I just moved here." And a week later, her situation blew up too. So here we go, divorced, but moving back to New Mexico again, and have been here ever since. And we had agreed that no more moving until my son is grown up. He was at the time maybe 4 or 5 years old. And we said, we'll stay here till he graduates from high school. And I knew that meant maybe working at McDonald's or construction or whatever, because there aren't that many broadcasting jobs here. I did have a good broadcasting job here for a while. That blew up too. So I think I lost 3 or 4 really good, high profile, well paying positions in about 4 years. And it's all them. It's all them. And look, I'm contributing to this myself. And so even as I turned my life around, accepted the Lord and started into broadcasting and on television, the commitment to stay here was good for me. It made me miss some chances to feed my ego and make some more money. But I'm really glad I came here. If I can, I want to share, it wasn't easy. I got fired. I was the program director at 93.3 KKOB. And I got fired from that and couldn't find anything that I wanted to do. And I had to do sales, which was like, oh, so hard for me and such a blow to my ego. And this was about the time I became a believer, just shortly after I became a believer, and I was surprised. God, I thought everything was supposed to be great if I accepted Jesus as the Lord and Savior. You know, and like, no. Things get very often get a lot worse. And they sure did for me. So I was struggling through a couple of sales jobs that I hated. And I had an awakening through a lesson at church. I came to realize I was being very ungrateful. And it was the closest thing ever to being born again, because I had to repent. I had to confess to the Lord that I was, you know, hey, I'm taking care of my son. I'm doing okay. It's not what I want to do, but I have all these blessings, and you're teaching me, Lord, and you're growing me. And if you want me to be a salesperson, I'll quit complaining about it, and I'll do my best to be good at it. And that did wonders for my attitude. It's like, I can't ever say I love doing the sales, but I got better at it, and I started having results and not being resentful and not being sad and depressed all the time. And lo and behold, an opening at Channel 4 came up for a part-time job, filling in occasionally. They'd call me once every 6 weeks when they were really hard up for a substitute, and I'd wake up in the middle of the night and run down there and do a fill-in and go home. And then they called and offered me a full-time job for the morning show. And it really wasn't a very good job, and it wasn't any more money than I was scraping along making doing the radio sales. And I was real unsure about taking that. It's like, man, just a month ago, Lord, I just prayed to you and said, I'll stay doing sales if that's what you want. Is this a test? I don't want to just run back out the door at the first opportunity and go back into the crazy lifestyle. I was really worried that the ego that can come with it, temptations that are kind of part of the package, if you allow them to be, that it was going to throw me right back in the same mess. And it's like, no, I don't want to go there. So I prayed really intently for 2 or 3 days because I had to get them an answer. And it's one of the few times, there have been maybe a half dozen times in my life when I have clearly heard the still small voice of God. It wasn't a big booming thing from the heavens, but I just heard the Lord say, if you can do this right, I can use it. And I laughed. I'm like, do it right, use it. I'm like, I'm going to be a morning weather goof in the middle of the night. How are you going to use that? But I knew that was the okay, that if you watch yourself, it'll be all right. And took the job, and it was slow developing, but within 30 to 60 days, I began to see really cool, very vivid examples of him using it. And it's kind of crazy to say that, being on a secular network television position like this, that it's been a ministry for me, but it truly has been. And it's given me so many opportunities to teach, to preach, to go speak at churches, to do things. And here I am 33 years later, very blessed. The job has blossomed into, you know, one of the best positions in broadcasting in the state. And, you know, I'm heading off here pretty soon. I won't be doing it very much longer, but my dream is to go on and to do ministry full time. I do a lot of ministry now as it is, but I want to do it without being tied down by the TV station, without the 2:20 a.m. alarm, for one thing, but also through my contract with them, through things that I can't say, subjects that I can't approach, just out of respect for my employer and honoring my contract. It's time, and I want to go ahead and move on while I've still got, you know, some time, some semblance of health, and chase this dream of mine to do ministry full time around the state, around the region, and see what the Lord has through my final years here.
So what is your first step?
Quitting. You know, it's been hard to get out the door.
You have told them, right? Because
Yeah. It's public, and we've been talking about it on the air and on my social media. It took me about 4 years. God put this in my heart about 4 years ago, and I started talking to pastor friends, guys that I'm really close with from other churches. And one of my friends, Pastor John Hill, he said, I get it. You're afraid. I said, afraid? Yeah, I know, because I was afraid. He left a beautiful job at Los Alamos Laboratories when he was a very young man and walked into a teeny tiny church with nothing and lost his nice car the first year he was there. So he helped me face the fact that I was afraid. And I had to sit down and pray and think and say, well, yeah, I say that I trust that God will guide and provide. Do I really? And, you know, coming from the background that I was raised in, where we just never had enough money, it's hard to walk. You don't quit a good job for no reason when you don't have something else lined up. So it took a while. Talked a lot about it with my wife. Finally went and talked to my boss about it. And let her know that it was on the horizon. My original plan was to retire at the 50th Balloon Fiesta. I thought that would be perfect timing. Things changed a little bit. We talked, you know, COVID got in the way and all of that stuff. And my contract was up then in October, but we agreed to extend it through this spring. And so I'm on air through March 31st doing the forecast. April, May, I'm doing sort of a goodbye tour. Going to hit 12 to 15 communities around the state, hit quite a number of locations here in Albuquerque with some live broadcasts, just a chance to say hello, take pictures, have some fun memories, I hope. And because I really do, I love the people. I've met a lot of celebrities, a lot of politicians, a lot of stars, but the people that really touch me, that I relate to, are just everyday people. That's what I am. And so then, you know, I run my charity, Beds for Kids. That takes a lot of my time now. And I'm on staff as a pastor at New Covenant Church. I'm not the lead guy, but I'm one of the main fill-ins when our lead pastor's out. I get an opportunity. I get invited to teach at a number of churches around the state each year. And I'm hoping that now that I'm out of the television world, that I'll get more invitations to do that. And also, one of my dreams is to develop an online multimedia ministry. People have been bugging me for 2 years to do a podcast. I'm like, why would I want to do a podcast? You know, but that hasn't really entered my idea stream yet. But I have some other ideas. I have the equipment and have the drive. Now all I need is the time and the opportunity to start putting it together. I have a couple book ideas too that I want to be able to put together. So we'll see.
Got a lot going on. So back up a little bit to Beds for Kids.
Yeah.
Tell us about it. How did it start?
Yeah, it's such a great example of God having plans for us that we have no clue about. It was never my hope, never my dream. I knew nothing about beds. But here we are 10 years later, 16,000 people put in clean, comfortable beds free of charge. And we do about 200 every month with two lowly paid part-time employees and about 75 to 100 volunteers. My wife Rose and I are still volunteers. I'm the president and the founder of our actual charitable organization with the IRS. Is called Up Before the Sun, S-O-N. And Beds for Kids is a branch of that. And it started with a private message on Facebook. A lady I didn't know said, my niece is 12. She has spina bifida so severely she can't get up and down into a regular bed. She's having to sleep on the couch, and it's literally killing her. Can you get her a hospital bed? And being the kind and caring Christian I am, my immediate response was, hospital bed? Well, no. Who do you think I am, lady? And I got up and walked away from the screen so frustrated that a total stranger would ask me for something so absurd. What do you think, I'm made of money or what? And a couple hours later, it's almost like God tapped me on the shoulder and said, you could ask, you know, that ask and you shall receive thing. And I have a big following on Facebook. And I went online and said, hey, I know this sounds weird, but there's a little girl that needs a hospital bed. Does anybody have one? And God's sense of humor kicked in right away, because the lady who had one was on my board of directors. We had started the charity a couple of years earlier, raising money for my little jail ministry and a couple of secular organizations, Make-A-Wish and things like that, for my charity motorcycle ride and everything. The the secretary of the board of directors, her father had been in a hospital bed for the final years of his life after being hit by a drunk driver. He'd passed away, and her mom held on to it for sentimental reasons, wouldn't get rid of it until she found out a little girl needed it. So I thought, how sweet is that? It's like, we have a hospital bed. Then I go back and dig through, and I find the message, and I read the small print. We live in Shiprock. And I'm like, oh, my Shiprock. And then it hits me, not only that, but I have no idea how to take apart a hospital bed or what, how big it is, or I know nothing. So I went back online right away and said, okay, we got the bed, but we have to get it to Shiprock. Does anybody know? And God stepped right in again. Medical equipment salesman popped in and said, hey, my buddy and I know how to do it. It's really easy. And we'll not only do it, we'll take it up there. And they sent pictures of little Dakota and her mom sitting on the bed, ear to ear smile, thumbs up. And it just, you know, it was so beautiful. And so I put the pictures on air, thanked everybody, went to bed thinking, boy, what a weird couple of days, you know? Next morning I woke up and my private message box was filled with, hey, I need a bed. I heard you're giving people beds. Can you help us get a bed? And I thought, are you serious? And so I started privately, you know, posting. Well, I would contact people privately and try to match up. And then I started posting, hey, this person needs a bed. Does anybody have one? And my wife, Rose, always the sensible one, comes in and says, you know, don't you ever read those stories about Craigslist? You're going to send a murderer to somebody's house, and it's going to be on your record. And I said, yeah, she's right. So I started telling people, just bring the bed to my house, and we'll put. So next thing I know, our three-car garage is filled with other people's beds, and my wife is seriously thinking about divorce. Can't blame her. And that's when I realized, my gosh, this is something. And the guy that was helping me at the time, we went online, solicited for some storage space and a place that had an underground parking garage that wasn't in use, let us go there for free for a couple of years. And that's kind of how Beds for Kids was born. We were doing it before we knew we really were doing it. We were just keeping track on a legal pad. And my friend at the time said, you know, let's check out. And we were right at 100 people we'd placed in beds. He said, you know, I bet if we got organized, I bet we could do 250 people in a year. And I said, do you think so? He said, oh, yeah, I bet we can if we just get some process going with this and start talking about it. Well, we did 500 people the first year, 1,000 people the second year, and every year since then we've done at least 2,500 people. I think our top year was 2,700, something like that, about 200 a month.
Wow.
And we have an 8,000 square foot warehouse and a box truck and a website and a lot of beautiful supporters, people who donate beds, people who come out and donate their time to hand out the beds, a lot of behind the scenes calling to set up because the need is so huge. Single moms, single dads, grandparents with kids, parents with kids who have disease, tragedy, fires, just everything imaginable. And the need is so huge. New Mexico, unfortunately, has usually the highest rate of childhood poverty of anybody in the nation. And kids are sleeping on the floor, on the couch, 3-4 to a bed. They're sharing beds with their parents or they're sleeping on the floor until dad goes to work and then they hop into bed. And it's something so simple, we don't even think about it, so basic, but it makes a big difference. And the sweetest thing is seeing these little kids that are 8, 10, sometimes 12 years old, jumping up and down because it's their first bed and they're so incredibly excited. And it's really sweet.
Keeps you grounded, doesn't it?
Oh my gosh, yeah. And you know, we are a Christian ministry. We serve anybody, no questions asked. I figure, you know, if you need to ask for a gently used bed, we do new beds when we have the funds. I think we've spent about $85,000 on new beds the past couple of years, but we do hundreds of thousands of dollars in gently used beds. And you know, a lot of my female friends will say, ooh, a used bed. Ooh, that kind of creeps me out. And I always say,
hotel?
You ever stay at a hotel? Yeah. Guess what you slept on, you know? But, you know, we inspect them. We make sure they're clean, that everything's good, and people are happy with it. So it's for the kids, it's a sense of well-being. It's better sleep, better health, a better chance at succeeding in school. And it's something that, you know, a lot of these kids will be able to keep from the time they're 8 through 18. They don't always last that long, depending on their size and all of that. But it's really cool. In the last couple of years, we've added books. I'm a real big proponent of early childhood reading. So we have the Kids Corner. And each child gets to go over and go through our little library and pick out brand new books of their own to take home to promote early childhood reading. We call it bedtime stories,
which keeps them out of prison.
I did a lot of prison ministry, a lot of youth detention, a lot of adult prison ministry, and reading is such a key.
It is. It's amazing.
And I tell kids, I still love to speak at the schools and tell the kids, you can be really whatever you set your mind to be, but you better be a good reader. That's really the key to almost anything that you want to learn to do. You can learn through listening, but reading is going to open up the world for you like nothing else.
Okay, so there was your first real good hint. I've got to get some hints out of you before I let you go.
Okay.
So someone who is watching this, and they've watched you for years and years and years, and they're thinking, there's no way, when they heard you say that even becoming a teacher was too high of an assertion for me, and then look at where you are now, what can they do right from where they are? Simple, little bitty things that they can do to start stepping toward what it is they want.
Oh my gosh. You know, there's so many books written on this, and I'm not an expert. I would say be honest with yourself, mm-hmm. because we're not. All those years when I was losing the jobs, when I was depressed, when I was suicidal, when I was ruining relationships, hurting the people who loved me most, my parents, my son, my wife at the time, it was always them, not me. And I never even imagined that I had an issue with substance abuse, with relationships, anything like that. So be honest with yourself. One of my favorite scriptures in the Bible is in James, and he says, scripture is designed as a mirror. And if you look in the mirror in the morning and don't do anything to fix your appearance and walk away, you've wasted that. So, you know, I think that the next thing is to look at your relationship with the Lord. I know from where I was that people don't want to be preached to, but Jesus has changed my life in unimaginable ways, and he continues to 33, 34 years later. And so I would say, begin to pray. I love to do funerals. That may sound a little macabre, but hearts are tender at funerals, and I don't pound on the pulpit and push people, but we're very gentle. And we ask people, whether or not you believe in God, open up your heart and talk to him tonight in the quiet stillness of your room. Just talk, just pray, just unload what's on your mind. Talk about your worries and your fears and your concerns and even your anger. And then listen. A lot of times we want to gripe to God, but we don't often take time to listen. You got to get some quiet time, some stillness. We're also plugged in with our ear pods and our iPods. And, you know, I mean, and I'm as guilty as anybody. I'm very electronically oriented. But we've got to get some quiet time. And then I always tell people, listen for what God has to say to you. He doesn't normally speak in a big, booming voice. Very often it seems like coincidence. Gosh, the pastor was just talking about that, and here happened to me today. What a coincidence. No, it's not the coincidence. That's God and his Holy Spirit speaking into your life and saying, pay attention, and something will be said, and then boom, 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 totally unrelated people over the next couple of weeks will bring up the same thing. So pay attention. And I would say, you know, give the Lord a fair chance. A lot of people like to denigrate the Bible who've never read it or only know a couple of scriptures or quote things that they think are in the Bible that really aren't, or totally misunderstand it. And that's common. It's very easy to do. I talked about that, you know, the scribes and the Pharisees, the Sadducees of the old days, Jesus criticized them because they knew the scriptures, but they misused them. They misquoted them. And the other thing that I would say is we have to recognize that life is short. Gosh, that's probably the leading motivator for me to retire. It's like, yeah, I'm going to do ministry. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. When? And so I came to the point, if not now, when? And doing funerals. I've done funerals for tiny children. I've done funerals for people in their 90s. For most of us, time is shorter than we think, and that shouldn't be depressing. It should be motivating. It is for me. I mean, I'm really excited right now. I have some issues. I was diagnosed with cancer a little over a year ago. I have some other health issues that have been more of a problem so far than the cancer is right now. But my clock is ticking. My joke is I'm somewhere deep in the fourth quarter, but don't know exactly how much time is left on the clock. And I want to use the time that I have for whatever I can do for the Lord. Whether or not somebody's at that point themselves, I would say seize the day. Grab every day. Let people know that you love them. Let them know that they're important to you. You can write a note. You can send an email. You can call somebody up. Forgive people. I do so many funerals where the worst thing is these people are so guilty because I never told them how much they meant to me, or I never went back and tried to patch things up. And we don't have that much time left. It goes by pretty quickly, and most people at the end are pretty stunned and pretty surprised. So I don't have all the answers, but I like to say I pray very regularly to the one who does. And sometimes we just have to keep asking and asking and asking. We don't know. It's not, you know, it's not like Siri where God pops right on and gives you the reference point, but he's very faithful and very true. And if we're sincere about wanting to get to know him and his plans for our life, I trust that he's always good. Scripture says he will answer. Sometimes the answer is no. Sometimes it's not yet. Sometimes it's, you know, when I was looking for a wonderful wife, a lifelong partner, I was very discouraged and I was praying, God, why haven't you put her in my life? And that's another time I heard his voice saying, she wouldn't like you very much just yet, Steve.
Right on. Right on. He has to have a great sense of humor or he wouldn't have made us so funny.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah.
Wow. That is cool. Okay. So, this is a lot. So if someone who's hearing this has been touched by what you've said and they really would like to talk to you personally.
Oh, yeah. I'd love that.
How can they reach you?
You know, the easiest way is through Facebook. I think I have about 60,000 close personal friends on my two Facebook pages. There's one Steve Stucker, and the other one is Steve Stucker, New Mexico Weatherman. I may have to change that since I'm retiring. I always joke I have the weirdest job combination, pastor and forecaster, but the forecaster part is going away. And I always joke that, you know, you can lie every now and then in one of those professions, but you got to speak the truth in the other. You can private message me through Messenger on Facebook. If you jump on the New Mexico Weatherman page, you can just hop in and comment, send messages and things like that. That's probably the easiest way. I also do a morning devotional called Morning Inspiration. It's a short piece of scripture followed with about a paragraph or two of explanation. And we have a free subscription list. It's on Facebook every morning, Monday through Friday. But we have a free subscription list for that too, but you can get it all through Facebook.
Okay. Well, I cannot thank you enough for how much love you give our state and just what you do and who you are and how you shine.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity. It's awkward to talk about myself so much, and I'm really uncomfortable with all this hubbub about retiring, but it's a blast. And I just want to do it right so God can use it.
What church are you going to be at?
New Covenant Church is where I'm at.
Okay. Guys, go see him.